Yeah, this is in fact a additional talk to one given 2 years ago by Brandon Robinson, who did talk about writing man pages using the classical Unix toolset for writing manual pages. That is a rough format. And 1 year later, Lars from Finland wanted to have a talk where he wanted to present an alternative of writing man pages using DocBook XML. And that somehow didn't happen. So because I had the same idea at the same time, I said, OK, then 1 year later, I will do the talk. So I'm doing this now. Writing manual pages without having to learn a little bit outdated text format. So, the history of online manual pages, just very short. The first online manuals appeared in 1979. Before that, all computer manuals or software manuals were printed manuals. So a lot of dead trees hanging around your computer. Since 1979, they were online available. The GNU project later invented a hypertext alternative to manual pages called Info. They had also a little bit of criticism towards the style of man pages because it's a very fixated format and they had other ideas on how to do it. Since the early 90s, a lot of online manuals in the Unix and also in the Windows world is based on HTML. And we have certain set of HTML-based help systems. In the Microsoft world, you have CHM or HTML help. We know of Java help. We have Yelp in GNOME. I think Eclipse help is also based on HTML and so on. And we have a lot of other online help formats, mainly ASCII text, readmes, and PDFs, which are in fact more for printing, but sometimes they are the only available online help. So what's so special about manual pages compared to other help formats? For us, for Debian, manual pages are special because they are mandated to have them for all executables, and we should have them for file formats, protocols, and whatnot. So we as Debian say we like manual pages. If you cite a man page, you see this very often. There's a name of the command or of the file format or whatever, and then in braces the number of the section, so a number from 1 to 9. You read manual pages using the man command, you know that, and there are other ways of accessing manual pages like dhelp, woman, which is inside of Emacs, a manual reader, or Yelp and GNOME, and other programs as well. Manual pages are reference documentation. They are not meant to be a tutorial or how-to. Sometimes they are, but it's not the original idea. And sometimes it's quite hard to get along with manual pages. For example, if you can't remember the name of a command, you cannot call the right manual page. Or sometimes you try man minus k to find something, and sometimes it works and sometimes not. or if you are looking for an example how to use the command, but the manual page is just too short or too complicated or does not include the example, and so on. And all main pages are located under user share main with subdirectories for the section or for the language and then the section, if it's not the C locale or English. So the layout of a manual page, you 1,000 times saw this. It always starts with a name of a command or a file format or whatever. Then there's a short synopsis giving the options in a short way of a command, for example. Then there's a description, more prosaic, what is this command meant for? If you're lucky, there's an example section. If you're more lucky, it is not empty. And C also is also very popular. Other typical sections include license, authors, known bugs, and so on. There are sections in the manual. The first section is about executable shell programs for every user. There you find the manual page for common commands like ls. You have a second section about system calls, a third one about library functions, four is about special files like device files and so on, five about file formats, configuration files and so on, six games, seven is stuff like UTF-8 format on ASCII table or things like that, that things that do not belong to other sections. Eight is mostly for the root account, system administrator commands. Nine is not a classical section. It's I think it came with Linux. It's about kernel routines and so on. And there are also more sections, for example, for TickleTK has some sections with an added N and so on. So manual pages are formatted in the rough format. It's a markup language, very much like Tech, LaTeX, XML, HTML, and so on, but older. And it is really, outdated, I would say, for nowadays. It's a format which is, in my opinion, not very good to read or to learn, and a little bit cryptic. If you're used to it, then it's fine, but I think it's relatively hard to get along with it nowadays. There are two flavors of RUF. NRUF is for the screen output and TRUF for printing. And in former times, all the Unix manuals, I don't know how it's now, but the classical Unix manuals are printed using TRUF on some Linotype machines or so. And there are special editors nowadays to edit man pages if you are not so confident with RUF man edit, for example. The other way I want to present here is to generate RUF manual pages from other formats so that it becomes easier. So, short diversion, what's about manual pages in Debian? We have many manual pages, really a lot, and about I didn't count it, but it was much more than most other distributions. Of course, we have more packages, and we have them in multiple languages. Because manual pages are mandated by our policy, package maintainers always have written missing manual pages for commands, gave them to upstream. So upstream very often accepted those manual pages. So if you're on a SUSE machine or Red Hat or somewhere and use a man page there, you will find very often this man page has written for the Debian system because no manual page exists before and so on. The quality of manual pages, both the upstream manual pages and the Debian ones, quality is very different. Sometimes it's completely useless, like this manual page has written and look in the README and no further information. And sometimes they're really good, presenting all necessary information in a nice way. So it varies greatly. One thing about UTF-8 with the latest release Edge, we want to have everything in UTF-8. Manual pages are not yet in UTF-8, or sometimes they are, but mostly not. This is because in manual pages you cannot state which encoding you are using. So the encoding is derived from the language actually by ROF, and GROF had problems with UTF-8. I heard that this is fixed now, but I'm not sure about this. We could try to go to UTF-8 with for the manual pages, but there has been some bad experience. I think Red Hat delivered Japanese manual pages in UTF-8 that were actually not readable. And I think Ubuntu had also problems changing the Spanish manual pages to UTF-8 without checking first whether it works, and it did not. There's a question.
My understanding is that the UTF-8 patches for Groff were basically rejected by upstream because they were really heinous and didn't really fit very well, and upstream was going to try to rewrite Groff to support UTF-8 properly, and I don't believe that work has ever actually finished.
It's not yet finished, you believe?
Yeah.
Okay. So there is the idea of having this as a release goal for Lenny. But, well, I mean, it's maybe not so important to have this stuff in UTF-8, but it would certainly help a little bit. Currently, we use, for example, EUC-JP for Japanese and ISO 88591 for European languages or for Central European languages. So some things I came across in Debian manual pages is that we have see also sections that point to other manual pages that do not exist in Debian at all. It's not that they are just not installed, they do not exist. This is mainly sometimes an upstream manual page is taken and there's a see also and nobody checked whether this manual page actually exists, or maybe it existed at one time but has been removed since and so on. Yeah, sometimes there are examples sections that are empty or useless. And yeah, this is something I'm not sure about whether it's good or bad. In some manual pages, there are references to other systems, so not Debian. Then the manual pages on a Sun system, you have to do it that way, and on HP, it's that way. and I'm not sure whether we want this. Sometimes it might be helpful, this additional information. For example, if I know that a command behaves differently on another system, it helps me to write portable shell scripts or something. On the other hand, some manual pages are cluttered with information that are not needed in Debian. So this is maybe something that is not really clear. There is a concept called profiling. I come to that maybe later, where you can write a source document with paragraphs about specific systems and generate later a manual page where only those paragraphs are in that are for your system. So you could have, for example, an HP specific section in your document, but later in the printed manual or online manual, it's not visible on a non-HP system and so on. I really cannot say a lot about English style. I'm not a native speaker. My English is flaky. So just a few points I found in typical how-tos on technical documentation. A manual page, I said it before, is a reference documentation, not tutorial, how-to, whatever. So if you write a man page, try to be brief and still complete. Technical documentation, including manual pages, should be written in a neutral style, so not including the person who actually wrote the manual page or the code. So if you write manual page in English, which is almost ever the case when you're writing a manual page for upstream, then try to get some English person to review it. A thing I came across a couple of times is hacker jargon or some jokes that are more insider jokes for geeks. A lot of manual pages are meant to be read by end users that are not geeks and they do not know hacker jargon, and it's just confusing. So also cultural references to certain things like our favorite science fiction series or to Monty Python or some things. I really like those, but not everybody knows about these things, and then it might be confusing. So better not do this in a manual page. Yeah, and of course, be friendly also on the manual page. Try not to include flaming against other software or whatever. There are a number of style guides online. I found the one by Fedora, I found the one by Ubuntu, and I found references to the one from GNOME, but I did not find the actual GNOME document. It must have existed sometime, but the online link is broken. So maybe somebody can find it using Google or whatever. I did not find any rules by Debian. I do not know whether we never had them or whatever. If anybody knows about Debian style guides for documentation, please speak up. So the format I present for writing manual pages is DocBook XML. The slides you are just looking at are also written in DocBook. DocBook is a semantic format. That does mean it is not about the presentation of information, but about the content. For example, if you type a file name in DocBook, you would probably mark it up as file name and not as, let's say, typewriter font 10 points or something. DocBook XML is a standard documentation format of a number of both free and non-free projects. The Linux kernel documentation uses DocBook, not only DocBook, but also DocBook, GNOME, KDE. I think in BSD it's also, but I'm not sure about it. It's used also in Novel, Sun, O'Reilly, and a couple of other companies. The idea of DocBook is that you have a single source format and can present all kinds of formats from that single source, for example, HTML, PDF, all kind of HTML-based online help formats, manual pages, of course, and there is a new round trip style sheet that generates open document format and even Microsoft Word format from DocBook and is able to get these maybe change documents then back to DocBook. You have a lot of tools dealing with DocBook, for example, tools generating DocBook from source code, tools to generate all kinds of output format from DocBook, specialized editors for DocBook or similar formats, and so on. So if we talk about manual pages, there are a number of tools to generate manual pages from DocBook. The best one, in my opinion, is using the official DocBook XSL style sheets together with an XSLT processor. I always use XSLT proc because it's very good and very fast. There are also Java-based ones that are free, but maybe because they're based on Java, it's a little bit slower. Then there is a tool called DocBook2x, which is a little bit older, but has the nice property of generating info pages. This is useful if you package something for Emacs, for example, then you may want to have online documentation in info format because that is what Emacs users expect. There's an older tool. It was, I think, one of my first Debian packages about 8 or 9 years ago, I don't remember exactly, that deals with the old DocBook XSTML format. And there's a reverse tool that produces DocBook from manual pages by Eric Raymond. It's called DocLifter. And I tried it just now. It works very well. It just crashes if you try to generate DocBook from the man page for the man command. But other man pages work well. So there are some examples for how a manual page in DocBook looks like. I will change to a decent editor to show that. So that is basically how this DocBook man page looks like. This is the manual page for Aptitude. And as you can see, it has a lot of XML markup, which is very verbose, unfortunately, but is much more readable than the corresponding NROF output I will show you as an for comparison now. I don't have it here. So this is another man page because I didn't have the aptitude one here. But as you can see, the XML format is much more verbose, but in my opinion, also much better readable and parsable. So of course, XML is easily parsable in all kinds of scripting languages because XML support nowadays is a built-in feature of all modern languages or libraries. You can have also man pages for function references, but I don't show this now, that becomes too boring. But if you want to really go into the matter, look for example at the documentation of glib, the library under the hood of GTK toolkit. All functions there are described in docbook XML, and you can easily look how they do these things. So when I looked at the manual pages, for example, for aptitude or the glib toolkit and so on, I came across a number of things which I didn't like. So first, if you write a manual page or if you have snippets of XML in additional files, please use always valid XML. That includes this nice header line you see in all XML documents, starting with less than, question mark, XML, and so on, version 1.0 or whatever. And if this line is in and it's valid XML, you can use any kind of XML editor to edit it, or VI or whatever. But if it's not valid XML, then at least the XML editors will maybe not be able to be used for this. Another thing in the ref entry info, use, if it's a Debian man page, use something like corp name Debian. Or if it's a GNU man page, then corp name GNU and whatever, because this will show up in the manual page in the, I think, lower left corner or so, which is a standard way to do it. If it's not in the, yeah, then it's not clear which is the source for that man page. It's also useful to include the date for the man page. Otherwise, the build date will be used, which is quite of useless. If you provide a man page for an upstream package, it is the best just to use the same license as the program has, so that for the man page there is no different licensing scheme than the program, which does not make sense. Or use GPL or use dual licensing or something. But it would be a little bit bad if you have a program under GPL and then put the manual page under a stricter license, for example. To include one XML document into another, use xInclude, not system entities, because this is much more flexible and it allows to include valid XML documents, including the XML header into another document, and not only snippets of XML that are not valid for themselves. Well, with the markup in DocBook, I said it before, it's very, very verbose, so don't overdo it. Mark a file name as file name, that's fine, but maybe it's a little bit overdone to mark a file name as device file and or directory. I mean, that is maybe a little bit too much. So there's a lot of criticism against DocBook, and I really can understand this. It's really verbose. All element names are long. It has hundreds of elements, hundreds of attributes for those elements. This is a little bit hard to cope with when you start. It's XML. A lot of people do not like XML. If you do not like XML, don't use DocBook. The free tools to generate PDF from DocBook, if you want to use PDF, for example, if you want to print out a manual page or if you write a book, the free tools are all always a little bit problematic. If you're using English or a Central European language, then it's relatively fine. But as soon as you start using Asian languages or right to left, then it is more difficult. So mainly FOB, DB LaTeX, and XML RAW are the ones I've tested, and here and there always are problems. So some conclusions, even if manual pages are a real old format, there are good reasons to provide them. Mainly for us, Debian, it's our policy. There's no reason anymore to learn RAW, in my opinion, maybe with the exception if you really have to use it or if you're maintaining gRAW. Using DocBook XML to generate manual pages is maybe not the easiest way, but it's not too hard. And you can easily have a lot of examples in the libglylib, libgtk, aptitude, and many other packages. DocBook is a very acceptable format and is used in a lot of projects. You can generate all kind of output from DocBook, so it's really flexible. If you write manual pages in DocBook XML, they will perfectly integrate with other documentation, books written in DocBook or articles. You can easily include it in a book. You can include easily a single paragraph in a book without having to cut and paste just by using XInclude. That's it for now. I'm open for questions, and if we have some more time, I can show, for example, XML editors or tools, but only if the need arises.
Hello, my name is Sylvain Legal. In fact, it's not a question, it's a suggestion, because I use DocBook XML for all my man pages in all my package, and it's great. It's really great because I switched to SGML DocBook to XML DocBook, and it's a thing which is very powerful. I just want to spot one thing. There is a tag which is called command synopsis. Okay, this tag in fact describes all the options you have for the command. For example, if we go back to the aptitude example, you will see that this command synopsis include all the arguments you can have. It's just right here. You see command, arg, group, and everything you can have. It's very powerful, but because if you pass this kind of thing, you can generate auto-completion bash script. Just to give you an example, it's powerful. So just write XSLT to transform this, and you got your bash auto-completion script for free. So it's great. Another point, I was not at the beginning of the conf, so I don't know if you talk about these tools. is that you can easily generate PO out of XML docbook using PO for R. You can just generate all the string from the docbook XML, and you can easily hand it and give it back to the translation team, and you will have something like all your man page translated to French, English, French, German, and all other language. So it's another point. And last point, just to make my own publicity, I'm working on a CDBS class. Maybe people know about CDBS. You will just have to give the root main page name, and it will just take the main page and run XSLTproc using Docbook XSL to generate a main page and put it in the right place and everything like that. So here is my own publicity. And so for now, the CDBS class is not shared, but if people want, they just have to contact me. So Sylvain Legal, I'm a Debian developer, so okay. We'll talk after the talk. Someone want another question?
A few years ago, DHMake, which creates Debian package examples, created docbook SGML example files. Is this changed by now, or should this be changed if XML is much better than SGML?
I think it now creates both. However, I would suggest to drop the SGML because it's more or less dead in the docbook world. Or it's really completely dead in the docbook world. So we could drop that.
Okay.
It's a good suggestion. Maybe we could file a wish list bug or something.
Yeah, I would like to see the examples of editors and different tools that you've used.
How many minutes do we have left? So I would show it here. So if no other questions are, I would take the last 5 minutes to show some docbook editors. And otherwise, I could show them later somewhere in the cafe or so. Okay. There are two kinds of editors for XML. The one that are source code based but really help you with the editing. I personally use Emacs. But that is something I would only suggest for people that, who are already used to Emacs. If you're a Vim user, there is something similar, but I do not know it because I use Emacs. So what is nice about those editors that they are context aware. For example, if I go to a paragraph, inside the paragraph, certain elements are allowed, and I type control return, and it gives me the list of elements allowed at this exact position. So for example, if I use address, then I can now try to look which attributes are allowed, and it only shows the attributes belonging to address. Arch is mainly used for profiling purposes. For example, this is only for AMD64. It doesn't make any sense now, but you get the idea. And inside of address, for example, only address-related information is allowed, and so on. So you can have this within Emacs, and I believe also within some specialized editors, and somebody told me that Vim also supports such a mode. Any Vim users here that can confirm or reject this idea? No. Then there are graphical editors. I will first present the free one, then a proprietary one. Here's another source code oriented editor. It's called MLView. It's a GNOME thing. I didn't use it myself. I just opened it here so you can try it. Sorry, that was the wrong one. Here. This is Amaya. Not the Debian developer, but the editor. Amaya is a graphical editor for XHTML and docbook formats and other XML stuff. You can see this is an aptitude manual page again, and it looks a little bit like it's, here above it does not look really good, but it's a little bit like what you see is what you get, but with docbook. Another editor, it's non-free, I have to say this, but it's nice. And maybe sometime we will have, where is it, XXE. It's written in Java. I've used this in my former company under Windows even, but it does run in Debian as well. It takes a long time to start up because it's Java, but then it's really nice. For example, I open up the, I see. I did something wrong. What you can have also with DocBook is having a CSS style sheet attached to it, which makes it possible to view the DocBook XML in your favorite web browser, and it looks like printed or something, but it's really only the DocBook XML. It's not changed to HTML or something. It's just with a CSS styling for the DocBook XML source. And that, unfortunately, XXE didn't like, so I remove this information. Is it so close? Maybe that. Yeah, now it works. So this is another what you see is what you get style of editor for DocBook. The only thing I do not like about this editor is that it's non-free, unfortunately, but it's free as in beer.
Have you used OpenOffice for editing DocBook at all?
I didn't try it, but I think the new round-trip style sheets allow to generate DocBook from OpenOffice and the other way around, but you have to use certain styles for DocBook inside of OpenOffice. I know that there are a couple of bug reports about this, because these round-trip style sheets are quite new. So a lot of people work on this stuff, and round-trip is meant to be used both with OpenOffice as with Microsoft Office.
Okay.
I think it will get some useful state later. There used to be another XSL transformation, but as far as I know, it never got really well. And with the new round-trip style sheets, the development does not go on the old one, as far as I know.
Okay. I understood OpenOffice could edit DocBook files directly.
Yeah. I mean, it depends. If you work together with people who are not used to working with XML source files, but are used to using a word processor like OpenOffice, then it is really good thing to have it.
Yeah, you just have to kind of control your styles.
I think it needs a lot of discipline.
Yeah. Thanks.
I just want to give a negative feedback on a tool which is called Conglomerate. This could be a great tool, but I think it has never been finished. So if you like bug, you can try Conglomerate. But if you want something reliable, I suggest you not to use Conglomerate for editing.
What editor?
Conglomerate.
Yeah, no, I tried it out and it is very buggy. It crashes and it has still a long way to go.
And you also showed MLView, and in my experience, MLView is very good for viewing HTML, but as soon as you try to edit, it just dies.
Here's MLView. Okay, any more questions? We are done. And I think the other speakers are already here. Okay, thank you for attention.